Good evening. We're coming to you live from the Anishinabek Nation head office in Nipissing First Nation. Good evening. I'm Cindy Males. I'm the Governance Communications Coordinator here at the Anishinabek Nation. Our Chief Governance Negotiator, Martin Baer, was unable to join us tonight. He sends his regrets. So joining me is Fred Belfay, the Legal Counsel for the Anishinabek Nation, and Jade Afolabi, the Fiscal Negotiator for the Anishinabek Nation and the Anishinabek Nation Governance Agreement. For the next hour, we'll take your questions about the governance agreement. If there's something that you would like to ask about, just this is the place to do it. These gentlemen will be able to give you the answers that you're looking for. I'll start us off tonight. First of all, Fred, what is the Anishinabek Nation Governance Agreement?
Thanks, Cindy. The Anishinabek Nation Governance Agreement is a self-government agreement between the government of Canada and the First Nations that successfully ratify the agreement. It covers lawmaking authority in several areas, including elections, First Nation elections, citizenship, or ibendazajig, which is the same as citizenship. It also covers lawmaking authority in culture and language, and management and operations of government. It also creates the Anishinabek Nation government, which is basically all the First Nations that successfully ratify the governance agreement.
So, should I talk a little bit about the financial, the fiscal arrangements that accompany that this agreement?
So, typically, if you have an agreement of this kind, you're going to need a financial component to it. So, an agreement of this kind is really it's what you call a self-government recognition agreement. So the point is for Canada to recognize the jurisdiction of those First Nations that successfully ratified. Along with that recognition, there is a taking on of additional responsibilities for those First Nations that they don't have right now, because Canada is going to lead the field for the areas that Fred just mentioned. So because of that, you're going to need a fiscal agreement to support the activities those First Nations will be undertaking.
So what are some of the benefits of the Anishinabek Nation Governance Agreement?
Well, first of all, the primary benefit is that we will no longer have the oversight of Canada in regards to our lawmaking. So we do not have to send our laws to Government of Canada to be approved. They have to be approved by the people of the community. So that's the primary benefit, is that lawmaking authority. Other benefits include, for the first time, really, us pulling together as one Anishinaabe family to support culture and language in our law development. Some First Nations are extremely strong in their culture and language, others not so much. We're going to work together to support each other and really push all our goals in that area.
So, and it's really just four areas, correct? The governance agreement, it only covers four areas. Speak to that.
So it is for those four areas that Fred mentioned. There is additional language in the agreement that you could say makes it four plus, kind of. So the four, again, are citizenship, language and culture, the operations of government, and elections. There is language as well, though, that says that if you pass a law on a matter that is integral to your culture, your traditions, that law, you have the grounds to pass that law as well, without having to send it to Canada for review, which would be the case right now. So it's still those four areas, but there's a potential for you to ease into additional areas that may be tangential to those four areas.
So let's talk a little bit. We received some questions through direct messaging, and let's go to some of those questions right now. Reading from the Anishinabek Nation Fiscal Agreement, there's a provision for calculating First Nations own source revenue. Can you confirm that the fiscal agreement requires First Nations to report their own source revenue, and what does that mean?
Okay, so the fiscal agreement requires reporting on own source revenue, but it doesn't require the implementation of an own source revenue formula. Those are two very different things. So I'll try to unpack that. First, what is own source revenue? Own source revenue is money that First Nations make. Now, typically, for a whole range of areas where Canada funds under the Indian Act, they'll be what you could call underfunded for those areas. So First Nations that have all those revenues will have to spend their own money to cover up the shortfall in funding. In a self-government agreement, because you negotiate, you try to get Canada to a level where Canada is funding sufficiently. But then Canada will then try to have in place an all source revenue formula to reduce that higher amount you're getting somewhat based on what Canada thinks you can pay. So that reduction, we've been able to forestall it, not have it apply in the agreement. So that means that the amount the First Nations are making will not go up against the amount they'll be getting from Canada. However, reporting on the formula, that is a financial report on the kinds of monies you make, which are already being reported anyway, you'll have to put that out there in the format that fits the own source revenue reporting requirements. So that's what that means.
So what if the agreement is ratified, what happens then, Fred? What happens after the vote?
Well, once the agreement is ratified, once the vote is all completed, and we see which First Nations really want to support the agreement and move forward with it, then we will organize together to implement what's called an implementation plan. And it's a plan, a step-by-step plan, to develop laws in those key areas that we spoke of, and to support those First Nations moving forward with a strong emphasis on culture and language throughout that process.
Now, the lawmaking authorities that would be recognized under the agreement in the four areas of language and culture, citizenship, elections, and First Nations government management, one of the questions that we received in a message regarding does the Indian Act not provide those authorities already for the First Nations?
Yes, the Indian Act does provide specific rules from the day we're born to the very day we die. In fact, the states is the last part of the Indian Act that applies to you, whether you can be buried on reserve. What this self-government agreement does is pull us out of those sections of the Indian Act that relate to membership, elections, and we sort of take that on together through this self-government agreement, but with a lot less federal involvement, and in fact, we do it ourselves. The First Nations and the Anishinabek Nation, which is the collective, work together to implement those activities.
Now, in terms of the agreement in the area of language and culture, just as an example, what sort of input will come from the citizens in developing those laws?
For language and culture, really, that's a key area that the leadership have been talking about and trying to do good things in. The kind of laws that we might develop under this might be, for example, signage laws. Right now we have a lot of First Nation entrepreneurs. They set up business. They do a great job of creating jobs and putting people to work. How about if we had a law that had culture and language requirements for signs, at the signs that they use, so that we could fulfill our objectives and all our language and cultural goals as communities with the help of our entrepreneurs? That would be an example. It's up to each First Nation to decide how to do that, what rules they would like to have in place to support their overall objectives.
Talk about some of the with the laws being developed in the First Nations. The First Nations, their autonomy is paramount here, right? Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so the agreement ensures that while there will be a new Anishinaabek Nation government, that the First Nations are paramount. What that means is that they have the final say on the laws that affect them. Number one, they can pass their own laws specifically. And number two, and perhaps even more important, there is nothing the Anishinaabek Nation can do that they cannot do. So what that means is, in practical terms, if there is something the Anishinaabek Nation is doing, but doing in a way that a First Nation doesn't agree with, that first the chicken simply decide, okay, you know what, for this specific fin, I will do it myself at home locally. So because of that, you get to participate in what the Anishinaabek Nation government is doing only if you want to. You don't have to. You can do it on your own. And if you do it on your own, there is no loss of funding. So you don't get less money because you aren't participating in something that the Anishinaabek Nation government is doing. Say, for example, a law across the board on signage, for example, like Fred talked about. If you don't want to as a community, you can say, you know, for us, we're not going to do that. But if you do, if you decide to do it, there is no additional money as well. So it's funding neutral. So you can decide based on, do we want to do it or not? Not based on, will I lose money or gain money?
So we're joined, we're live from the Anishinaabek Nation headquarters in Nipissing First Nation. If you have a question for Jadea Falabi, our fiscal negotiator, and Fred Belfay, the legal counsel for the Anishinaabek Nation, if you have some questions with regards to the Anishinaabek Nation governance agreement, send them in. Let us know where you're from, and we'll be happy to get some answers. We did receive some questions earlier. So if the governance agreement is ratified and the money starts flowing through the Anishinaabek Nation government, how much of an administrative fee will be taken off the money that's meant for, earmarked for First Nations?
So Cindy, that's a very good question. So we realized at the outset that that may be an issue, that if we're able to negotiate a large amount from Canada, that it may be the issue of funding this central organ, this Anishinaabek Nation government, and the result may be that what the First Nations are supposed to be getting is being undercut by the need to fund the central entity. So what we were able to do is negotiate a separate amount for that entity. So the result is that a First Nation getting X amount will get X amount, because the Anishinaabek Nation government has its own separate funding. So none of that money will go towards funding the Anishinaabek Nation. What the First Nation is going to be getting is what it's going to be getting.
So the fiscal arrangements agreement calls for a 7 times increase in funding. Should a 7 times increase in what funding, and what does that mean?
Okay, so that's another good question. So the Anishinaabek Nation governance agreement deals with governance. And governance covers the four areas we just spoke about, or four areas plus that we just spoke about. Now, funding for those areas is encapsulated or comes together in something that Canada calls band support funding. So the program that funds those four areas right now under the Indian Act is called band support funding. So that's the amount that is seen as 7 times increase, is that band support funding. So that goes up on average for the 41st Nations by 7 times. In some cases, because a specific First Nation might be so underfunded currently, the amount will be more than 7 times. In some cases, it may be a little less than 7 times, so maybe about 6.2 times, if you crunch the numbers. But on average across the board, it's about 7 times.
So why is that money, that increase, tied to this agreement?
So the key thing to understand here is that it's about increased responsibility and also about catch up from a past that has been that has seen a huge amount of underfunding. So the four areas in the agreement, if you think about them, elections, citizenship, those are areas where right now Canada has a say in, essentially. Now, if you're going to sign a self-government recognition agreement with Canada like this is, you are going to have Canada vacate those areas. Now, what Canada is stipulating in those areas may be very minor or maybe very great. It all depends on what it is. But ultimately, you're having Canada lead the field. And Canada is leading the field and is expecting First Nations to then, you know, carry the mantle in those areas and serve your citizens in those areas, then the funding has to be available for it. Now, that funding wouldn't have to be so much of an increase if adequate funding has been the history, but it hasn't been. The funding has been very inadequate for a long time, so the need for a catch-up is very important, and that's why we're seeing the kind of increase we're seeing.
Now, one of the questions we've received from one of our viewers is regarding open source revenue, and that it should have nothing to do with education funding. Talk a little bit about how the governance agreement and the education agreements, how they'll work together.
Okay, so the governance agreement and the education agreement are entirely separate agreements. However, they both commit, it's not just the case of one committing, they both commit that for financial matters, there's going to be an amalgamation of their two fiscal agreements into the one agreement. So that for Canada can have, in terms of funding, what Canada calls a single window approach. So essentially, think of it as cutting a single check for the entire government and for all the services, education and governance. So that's the objective. That single check isn't going to be reduced for education because of governance, or reduced for governance because of education. So the amounts will not change because one more agreement is available. The amount will stay the same. So the impact then of governance on education in terms of funding is nil. In terms of process, there will be a small alteration because there will be what both agreements have committed to, which is to bring the fiscal matters into a single agreement for ease of administration, reducing inefficiencies, things like that.
Here's another question that's come from Hayden. It says, I know that there is much discussion about making laws without Canada's oversight or approval, but when that law is passed and ultimately comes in conflict with a provincial or federal law, which law prevails?
So that's another good question. Thank you, Hayden. So a law, the agreement sets out clearly, the governance agreement, but a law on an issue that the agreement covers. So for example, a law on the citizenship of any of the First Nations that ratify the agreement. That law will trump federal law or provincial law on the same matter. So as long as the issue is, for example, let's use a real life example. So Dukis, for example, Dukis First Nation passes an election law or citizenship law. If there is an issue where there is an other election law, for Dukis, and right now it's in the Indian Act, the law of Dukis will trump the law of Canada, which is in the Indian Act. If the law passed is not on an issue in the agreement, so if the law passed is, for example, regulating interprovincial trade between Ontario and Quebec, for example, or if the law passed is on, say, the rights of individuals, say mobility rights to move from point A to point B, which is protected in the charter, then that law, of course, the charter will trump that. So it depends on what the law is. If the law is on an issue in the agreement, the First Nations law trumps federal or provincial laws.
Now, what about Fred, go ahead.
The nice thing about the governance agreement is that almost all these lawmaking areas, there is no provincial jurisdiction. So when it comes to First Nation membership, under the agreement, it's Anishinabek Nation and First Nation Ibendazajig, which is citizenship. There is no provincial equivalency in terms of law. Same with First Nation elections, same issue there. There is no provincial jurisdiction in that area. So it's not really a conflict of laws issue.
Okay. Gentlemen, thank you so much. We're going to take a couple of minute pause just to fix some technical issues. So everyone who's watching, stay with us, and we're working to fix those issues now.